Now we want to look at exploratory analysis and introduction to inferential statistics. So you remember that we said inferential statistics is the statistics that deals with inferring. So you expect to see a population, a bigger population, and then from that population we pull out a sample. And then we perform some test on the sample. And then the results, we infer them back to the what? To the population. So that's inferential statistics. And then exploratory analysis is part of the first part of statistics, which is what? Descriptive. The descriptive part, that has to do with the graphs in this case. So, well, this is the first part of data analysis. So when you're given data, the first thing you try to explore your data. So this is the first look at your data. So you want to explore. So you explore your data by doing data analysis, exploratory data analysis. This usually encompasses drawing graphs to check whether assumptions are met, certain assumptions are met, so that you can do your formal analysis. So example of graphs that are there, you have got a scatter plot, you have got index plot, and these ones can be done easily. Maybe let's say you have got that data set and then you want to do your scatter plot. Unfortunately, some of the things don't appear on the screen. So that's the scatter plot and the index plot. Some call it the lines plot, and then we've got a box and whisker. So in that data set, I want you to come up with box and whisker for your levels. You've got level one, I think there's two, there's five, there's six and seven. So I want you to come up with different box and whisker or box plot for these levels, and the variable of interest is your amount or gold grades, on those different levels. So this is the variable of interest. There's also another variable that you can still use, which is MPH2. So you can also still use that one. So this is the project that you are supposed to complete, is already uploaded on the Google class with the name data analysis, and is due on the 4th. So let's make sure we attempt that on the 4th of April. Then the next thing will be understanding the normal distribution. So we're now going back to the normal distribution, the basics of normal distribution. So the fundamental way of computing or converting normality is using the z-scores, and the formula for the standard normal z-scores is given by z is equal to xi minus the mean x bar everything over the standard deviation of the sample. And then the standardized scores can be used to plot the QQ plots, which are the quantile plots. So you can as well come up with the z scores, because if you go to this variable of interest, you can compute the mean, huh? Huh? K can compute the mean for that, can also compute the standard deviation. Hence, you can compute the z-scores for all xi. Then for using those z-scores, you can then plot and try to visualize your probability, your probability plots, your PP plots, and your QQ plots. So the QQ plots and the PP plots are performed using the z-scores. So those are, that's the example of the QQ plot. It should look like that. So maybe in analyzing that, for the normality, these QQ plots are usually used to test for normality, that your data is normally distributed. And so if you have got points that are very far from this line, it means that this assumption of normality is not met. So you expect your points to be along the line. So if you want to check before you perform this, the inferential statistics, you need to perform these descriptive statistics and then try to check why. And then try to check why those points are very far. And this point, which is very far, sometimes is called an outlier. What are the reasons for observing outliers? The reasons might be maybe someone made a error in typing or inputting the data or entering the data. So we get these results with outliers. We need to investigate where the outliers are coming from. So those are different types of outliers. One is standardized, and then the normal plot, which I said we expect them at least to lie in that graph. Usually, a tree for outliers, what usually other people do is they remove them from the data set and perform their analysis without the outliers. But the recommended way to deal with outliers is, first of all, try to investigate where these outliers are coming from, the reason behind. Because by removing them, sometimes you lose a lot of information that was going to be essential. Another way for dealing with outliers, maybe not necessarily that will, because your assumptions are not met, you can try transforming. Transformation of your data. So initially, if you have got your data as a variable one, you might want to transform it and maybe try square root of that variable, so as to normalize it, or you can even try to take logarithms of the variable, create another column in your data set Excel sheet, and then compute those transforms and try to check if it's now transformed, does it still violate your assumption? So it is clear that outliers we see in the box plot are those observations that depart off the line. So that's how you can interpret. That's how you can interpret your graphs that you gain from exploratory data analysis. The relationships between covariance and correlation. Remember, in the previous lesson, we computed the correlation. So we saw the formula for the correlation, and that was given by, what was the formula for the correlation? Mu x over sigma. The coefficient of, so if you missed that, go back to those previous slides. So in many cases, we are interested in how variables are related. So if you see someone saying, I'm doing a project and I'm interested in a relationship or interested in relationships. So these tests are also important to establish relationships. So if you've got bivalent, if you're doing a bivalent analysis, which means that you are checking a relationship between two variables. So bivalent two, for example, if you've got X and Y value. And then in some other cases, we perform multivariate analysis. Multivariate analysis means multiple variables, like the data set that we have in our projects. That tests for how many variables? Many multiple variables. More than two. Yes. Suppose we have two variables, X and Y, and each of these variables is first and second moment. And the second moment, we say it is what is the second moment? The variance. So, it's the second, first, moment, the first is the mean, represented by Dx. And then an important concept is the joint variation or the expected value of the product of the two variables, where each one is centered at the mean. This is the core variance, and the core variance is given by this formula where we are having the covariance of 2. So the covariance is measures the variance between two variables. The variance measures the variance between one variable. So covariance is with two variables. So this will be E of x minus the mu of x times y minus mu. You recall that the formula for variance is what? What was the formula for variance? Sigma x squared. What was the formula? It was E bracket what? X minus mu x everything what? Squared close bracket. Yeah? Now that we have got two variables, we have separated this square. Yeah? We are multiplying this one and this one. So if x is equal to y, if x is equal to y, this formula is equal to that one. Yeah? So the variance is the same as the covariance of single variable. And then the correlation coefficient obtained by scaling covariance to values less than or equal to 1. So the scaling factor is the product of two standard deviations. So in this case, our correlation coefficient is given by the covariance everything divided by the product of the standard deviation of x times the standard deviation of y. And in this case, the correlation coefficient of a single variable is always equal to 1. So sometimes when you perform your correlation in your softwares, you will discover if this is variable, let's say x, this is variable z, this is variable y. And then this is variable what? X, this is variable Z, this is variable what? Y. So where X and X you perform, this will always give you a correlation of. Where there is Z and Z, this is always a correlation. Where there is Y and Y, the correlation is 1. And then these ones show the relationships between Y and X, this one Y and Z. This one should be the same as this one. This one should be the same as that one. Alright. So I don't know whether this is, I maybe let me mention it because I feel like it's important. Correlation ranges from minus 1 to, it ranges from minus 1 to 1. Eh? So if you get a correlation which is from minus 1 to 0, this is called a negative correlation. Eh? So it means that the relationship is negative. When the other variable is increasing, the other variable is decreasing. Eh? And then when the correlation is ranging from 0 to 1, we call this a positive correlation. Eh? But we have got some specific ranges. For example, if it's between 1, minus 1, and minus 0.5, I'm now using the set notation. So if the correlation is between this interval, we say this is what? Strongly negatively correlated. Yeah? If it's between 0.5 and 1, this means that there's a strong positive correlation. So this is how we measure relationship of variables. A negative relation means that the other variable is increasing and then the other one is decreasing. A positive correlation, both of them are increasing. An increase in Y will affect an increase in X. So thank you.